According to the cloud.
Mommy,
Okay.
you know what? Yeah, I'm going to run and grab my water. I'll be right back.
Okay, I'll just let them in while you're doing that.
Okay.
And I'm gonna admit the people of the world. I was doing music before, but then YouTube got mad at me because it's like, did I have the rights to the music that I play in our intros? I don't. So I'll just I can just like sing you a song. Hello, welcome, welcome. Letting in the people into the Zooms on this morning on the West Coast, afternoon on the East, and my mountain people, I think it's still morning. My British people, good evening to my British people. What other time zones we got going on? My central folks, what time is it over there? It starts to get confusing. Then the reason for me is because numbers, my friends. I'm really bad at numbers, but you can just admit everyone. Hello, welcome, welcome. Come on into the Zooms. Hey, Luke, what's up? Great to see you. All right, Central and New. Thank you so much, Darius. I appreciate that. Central time, right? It's noon. That's a glorious hour, the hour of noon. For me, usually that's like, oh, dang, how is the morning gone? And what have I accomplished? Hello from Des Moines, Anne. What's up? Great to see you. We got Atlanta with Marion. I really miss Atlanta. I love that town. City. We got Dave, who we know joins us from PDX. What a happy place that is. I was talking to my friend about the bike ride, the naked bike ride, and I was like, oh, my friend, she goes on the bike ride, and that's so nice that she's a guy that can go to that with her. And my friend was like, Siobhan, everyone goes to that in Portland. That's not unique, you know? And I was like, right. Portland. Okay. Welcome, my friends. Welcome, Bina in New Jersey. Hello to Micah from Wild, Colorado. Hello to Malia in Edmonds, Washington. Yes, we do love the Pacific Northwest. Welcome, everybody. Okay, rock and roll. We are recording because I am on my game today. My name is Siobhan. I am your host for this hour, the 39th session. We're almost 40 years old. Isn't that such a beautiful thing? What a number! And so, if this is your first time, welcome. We're so happy to have you. We do these every other week, except for when there's holidays that we are observing. But we're happy to be back and rock and roll, hanging out on this whatever time it is for you all to talk about voiceover here at Edge. And joining me to my Zoom, let's see, this is my right hand, so he's on my Zoom left. I do have our Chief Edge Officer, David Goldberg. David, good day to you. How are you?
Yeah, good day. Did you say a naked bike ride?
Oh yeah, you know the naked bike ride. You guys know this.
No, that sounds very uncomfortable, I must say.
I know. I've never done it. I will be honest, but it's a thing. My Portland people can. It's not. He knows what I'm talking about. It's not uncomfortable, but it is a thing, an annual or maybe regular experience that at least happens in that part of the world.
I think it would be uncomfortable just to like be naked in front of other people, much less like physically sitting on a bike seat is uncomfortable enough, even when a guy is wearing padded shorts. Without the pads, I'm not sure how that would happen.
Jimmy wants to know if the Naked Cowboy from New York City has ever attended, and that's a great question. And I want you all to know that I'm from Maryland. And when I was in high school, I went on a trip to New York City to see a Broadway show, and I took photos with the Naked Cowboy. And my Catholic mother was not happy about that. I'll just say because he grabs your butt, and then you grab his. Like it's a thing that happened, and my mom was very disturbed. Poor thing. She didn't know what the world was going to turn into years later. But anyway, so it's like, Mom, that's nothing. It's not a competitive pace.
Everything.
I love how we're getting started today. This is actually appropriate. I'm a little disturbed now myself, Barry. Sorry, darling. We're just kicking off this equinox, right? Isn't it officially autumn? So clearly the full moon, we're just doing all the things here today. So we've got David joining us as our chief edge officer and our special guest today. I'm so delighted to present again. We haven't had him. It's been like a year really since he's joined us, but he has been with us before and he joins us again. He's our literal home studio specialist and expert, my friend Dan Friedman. How are you, darling?
better now that you're here, Siobhan. I love this girl. She's so much fun. We have had some great times together.
We really have. Dan, I'm so happy that you're here with us to talk all things VO. And for my people with home studio questions, provided not generic things like what kind of mic do you recommend, we can still talk a lot of home studio in general and then get into specifics later on if that is something that you need. For your Zoom experience, I like the gallery mode. I know a lot of folks have their cameras on, which is really fun for me to see everybody hopefully laughing at my jokes. It's okay if not, I won't take it personally. But if you want to blow people up, of course, you can use the interview on the right-hand corner. Your view options will give you speaker mode, so you can just highlight whoever is talking if you want to see my sweet face or the beautiful faces of Dan and David. Otherwise, you can also pin someone, so if you just want to like check out Dan's studio, he wouldn't even know it. That's the magical thing about Zoom. You can just pin him. That's your prerogative. But the recording will be in gallery because that is how this is going to go. And yes, this will be on YouTube this weekend, and you can check it out there. So, okay, so let's get this going. And I just want to start the way I like to start when we have our special guest stars. And I just want to check in with you, Dan. And first of all, give us some origin story for folks who don't know you yet about your trajectory that brought you into voiceover, maybe even how you got to Edge, and your love, your deep love of home studios.
And I was born in 1971. No, I'm just kidding. You know, we don't have to go that far back. So I actually became an audio engineer in 1995. I ran live sound at clubs and for bands all over Tampa and Atlanta and all of that good stuff for a long time. I worked in radio for a number of years as well during that same time. Then I worked in a recording studio that specialized in voiceover for telephone. Which was super boring, but that's okay. I was there for a year. And it really introduced me to some amazing voice actors. This is all the way back in like 2000 now. So it was, you know, a long time ago. And I met some great people who coached me and taught me how to really become a great director and subsequently, a few years later, a voice actor as well. I wrote a book called Sound Advice, Voiceover from an Audio Engineer's Perspective, which was published in 2011. It's still relevant today. I wrote the book very specifically so that it would be relevant for a long time to come. And I've been with Edge, I think about little after that book was published. I think I met David at FAFCON 2 back in 2011. And about a year later or so, I started, working with Edge to help students. And I have to say that, you know, I really love teaching and directing both performance stuff and home studio stuff. So it's just nice that, I'm able to connect with people here, and I'm glad to be here with all of you today. Great to see everybody's smiling faces.
And Dan, tell us where you join us from.
Yes, I'm in Asheville, North Carolina, the beautiful mountains, and I would not live anywhere else. As a matter of fact, I was just telling Siobhan before we got on today, it's like the perfect ABC day, another beautiful Carolina day, because it is blue skies here, not a cloud in the sky. It's about 60 degrees today, which is so we're really ringing in the first day of fall with the weather. And so it's got a nice little nip in the air, and I dig that. This is really about my favorite time of year, other than allergy season. So I might have to clear my throat a few times.
Yeah, much love and compassion to my humans with allergies, because I know that there is suffering happening for y'all. Yeah, so I wanted to highlight that just as a reminder that, obviously. I think folks know this anyway, but our coaches at Edge are spread out quite all over the place. And We really encourage and empower remote work and remote training as a thing that we want folks to remember that they can do. And of course, we know that in the pandemic that that is something that has become more of a thing. But to maintain that as like wherever you are, you can still do the stuff. So I just wanted to, yeah.
I was just going to say, I've actually been working, you know, with people remotely for over 20 years. So this actually has been a thing that's been going on for a very long time. It's just that a lot of people don't really realize that the pandemic has brought a lot of people on board to remote working for the first time. But as a voice actor, I mean, I've been working with people this way for over 20 years via ISDN before Source Connect and all of that. So this is nothing new for me. You know, it's pretty funny. I told people when the pandemic and quarantine happened, I'm like, are you kidding? I've been training for this for like 15 years. There's not, I'm totally prepared for pandemic life. I have no problem with it. I've been sitting, I don't have that shirt on today, but I have a shirt that says I sit in a dark padded room hearing voices and talking to myself. And that's really kind of what I do. So yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of self-branding t-shirts going on today. Dan's shirt has the QR code for his website, so you can just, you know, scan him and go to his site if you hang out with him in person, which is a really...
Go to the blog. Lots of good free information there. Lots of stuff that you can, you know, read about. Oh, I see there's some phones coming up here.
Yeah, get it. Dan, I'm really curious, actually... I'm sort of jumping off point from that. There's been a lot of discussion, I know, in a lot of the performance world, I'll say, for things after the pandemic or amidst this time of all this space at home, where there are new challenges that we had to face, where even potentially people were talking about, you know, clients wanting to charge the same thing, but or wanting to pay the same thing, but you having to refurbish your space or pay for new things or have other challenges. And I'm curious if there were new obstacles or challenges or expenses that came up for you in the past year and a half.
Not so much for me personally. And I think that's just because I've been home for such a long time. I mean, I've worked from home now really since 2014. Exclusively from home. So I can't say that there were new challenges for me personally, but I can say that I always recommend that people, when they are invoicing a client, for instance, don't just invoice, you know, don't just make a line item for the work that you've done as far as the spots or the narration, but put a studio line item there. So in other words, put a line item that says studio time, 1 hour, something like that. Not only is it right to charge for your studio, because of course you have invested in this and all of that, but it also gives you a little bit of wiggle room when it comes to negotiating rates. So if you're kind of on the fence with something, you can say, hey, you know what? I'll waive the studio time on this one. And then they think they're getting something special. And you aren't, you know, it's something that maybe you don't charge as a line item already anyway. So now if you get them to pay it, great. And if you don't, at least it gives you some negotiating. So I do think that that is a really good way to go when it comes to that sort of that's a challenge in a way.
Yeah, that's actually awesome. David.
Yeah, I have a couple of thoughts. Hey, everyone. First, a side note. So Siobhan was talking about branding shirts. So I have to show you my own shirt today, just in case in my senior years, I forget my name. There it is. That is from my younger son. He made that. It's pretty cool. Two things of relevance. One is regarding invoicing your clients as a voice actor, right? I think, as Dan said, it's great to use line items. And you can expand upon that, and you can put down line items for remote connection or editing, any different what's the word I'm looking for? Oh, crud! I'm forgetting. No, any different like product that you provide to your clients, even if you don't charge extra for it, at least line item it, and maybe even say included in your invoice, because the client will feel that they're getting something more, they're getting something special. You know, always let clients know how much you're giving to them. And then Siobhan, you asked the question about, to Dan, you asked what has been challenging over the past year. I'll tell you, on our end, on the production studio end, we had a really challenging year and a half. When the pandemic hit, we were pretty screwed as a production company, because at Edge, we record a lot of very, very long programs, a lot of long narrations. It could be a series of 100 training videos, or even a single training video that is many, many hours long, and very long audiobooks. And all of this long form narration happens on a daily basis. And one of the things we've always offered our clients is that we very often will bring the voice actors into our own studios and record them there. But when the pandemic hit, obviously we could no longer bring the voice actors into our own home studios. So now the voice actors needed to start recording the rest of the project from their home studio. Unfortunately, a lot of them had pretty crappy sounding home studios. And now we were faced telling a client, well, look, you want to continue the training video series with the same voice actor. And that makes logical sense. There's no reason to switch to another voice actor, but the voice actor studio doesn't sound good. And so we were faced with this dilemma, clients saying, well, we want the same voice actor. And we could say either to the client, well, we need to start all over again with a different voice actor, or you'll have a voice actor, the same voice actor, but the quality will change in the midst of the training series. What we ended up having to do is actually help voice actors outfit their studios. And I'm sure Dan can share a lot of information on this over the next hour, but it's really pretty easy to treat your studio acoustically and with the equipment. It's not difficult at all. It's not even that costly, but it needs to be done. And I think the lesson to all of you is that you should always be prepared. Make sure your studio really sounds good, because the day that a client says to you, hey, we don't want you to record in our studio, we want you to record from home, you need to have that studio that sounds tip top, that has broadcast quality. And I'll tell you, probably 99% of voiceover projects are recorded from home studios these days. You know, one of the reasons why we survive in New York City, we have 5 studios, and the reason why we survive is because we record things that are just not single voice actors. We record a lot of celebrity spots or authors who don't have home studios, or recordings which require multiple voice actors. Those things can't often be done or can't easily be done from home studios. But again, the point is, guys, make sure your home studio is fantastic. You know, if you're not sure, book a session with Dan. Let him work with you privately. You know, you can send any of the admin people in our office some recorded files, and then they can get them to Dan, and Dan can take a listen. And he's really astute at this stuff. You know, he can listen to your, it's amazing. He can listen to your recording and say, it sounds like you have a wall about 5 feet from you that's not acoustically treated. Like, you need to treat that wall, or you need to change this, or there's a buzz here, or your noise floor is that. But yeah, make sure you're ready to go, guys.
Yeah, it's really important to understand a microphone picks up 2 things. It picks up the performer, in this case us, and the environment in which that performer exists. So therefore, those are the 2 most important things that you have in your signal chain before any equipment at all. So it is really important to keep that in mind. The equipment is considerably secondary to those first 2 things. Your performance has to be amazing, and your environment has to be stellar. To compete in this world today, more so than ever, you really do have to have a great environment. Remember, you're competing against people who've done this for 30 and 40 years. You're also competing against those who've been coming up and are really paying attention to studio acoustics and things like that. So it really is something that you do want to focus on and deal with before spending a bunch of money on nice preamps and, you know, stuff that's bells and whistles, fun stuff that lights up and has shiny knobs.
Right. You know, and honestly, guys, a pretty inexpensive microphone, like a $100 microphone, even a $100 USB microphone, will sound significantly better in a good sounding acoustically treated studio, as opposed to a $5,000 microphone in a cruddy environment. Because the expensive microphone will pick up all of the noise, the resonance, the echo, the, you know, all the sounds that you don't want picked up. That expensive microphone will pick it all up. So yeah, better to put your money, if you're limited on resources, put your money into the acoustics of your studio first. Get a good sounding environment, and then worry about the equipment secondary.
And it's all about experts here. I love this, and I want to enforce, as someone who gets anxious about this sort of thing, that budgeting and taking your time, but planning, but prioritizing is going to help you get in the brain space to figure this out. And honestly, we always emphasize this, and we do have Dan here. So talking to someone like Dan who understands and cares can also ease your anxiety about, like, how in the world am I going to do this? So that's what training is for, and that's what talking to specialists and experts is for, is to help you. And yes, it's adding an expense in your life, but boy, it's worth it than going through the YouTube tunnels of agony to try to do it on your own.
That world.
Yeah, really. Less and less do we desire. So I'm going to tackle some of these questions. My friends, if you have questions for us today, for the next 40 minutes, I'm just going to take them from the chat, so drop anything at all. Remember also that Dan is, of course, a voice actor, so if you're curious about performance things as well. And we'll spin these, we'll throw these out to both David and Dan to sort of answer whatever kinds of things are on your mind today. And this one is really specific, but I'm going to do it because my sweet Alexis is awesome. And hey, Alexis, everyone, like, say hi to her. She's the best, and she's been with us this entire year and a half. First of all, Dan, she's jealous of you being in Asheville and your weather.
Everybody. And then,
yeah, well, I don't know if people remember this from last summer, but we're going to go to Dan's place, and he's going to bake us pies, and we're all going to do karaoke. That's the plan? Okay, cool. We're on. So...
live band karaoke. I don't do recorded music karaoke. I play with a live band.
Go big or go home. Oh, we all are at home, so we go big. That's that's what we're doing. So this question is not about home studio. It's, she says, when studying a second language, and this could be for either of you, but we'll start with Dan. At what point, Dan, do folks who are studying a second language, do you think they can look for VO work in that second language?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And it's kind of one that is very dependent upon you as the voice actor. I would say the most important thing would be, of course, you know, using your skills and foundations that you're learning as a when you're getting coaching and all of that. All those same skills apply to whatever language you're doing, but I would certainly suggest that you talk to other people that actually speak that language natively and get their kind of assessment, right? I don't speak a second language, so it's not something that I can really relate to in that way. You know, my mom was very disappointed that I did not apply myself in high school when it came to a second language. The funny thing is, they actually put me in French, and my mom's like, "You live in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. You need to be in Spanish." And she was logically correct. However, I think I enjoyed French a little bit more. Anyhow, I didn't learn either language, so it really didn't benefit me at all. So there you go. But yeah, I would speak to people that speak that language natively, and make sure that they feel comfortable with your delivery, your pronunciation, your dialect. Just think Spanish alone. Good example, right? There's Latin American Spanish. There's Spain Spanish. There's Miami Spanish, right? So there's just a different number of dialects. So it's not as simple as just saying, hey, I've learned a second language, I'm going to go dive in now. Because there are certain regionalisms and dialects with those languages, just like, you know, the New York accent is different than the Southern accent and all of that. So definitely things to be aware of, but I would say definitely speak to native speakers. Mm.
David, anything else?
Yeah, I think the key thing, well, there are a couple of key things. It is a great question. And one I don't think we've ever had in the previous 39 programs. I would not even entertain the idea of recording a demo in another language until you're certain, as Dan said, that you can speak that language neutrally. You don't need to necessarily be able to converse fluently, but you need to sound native. You need to speak the language fluently. You need to be able to market for that language. But there's an interesting thing. I'll tell you that a lot of voice actors who are semi-neutral with another language will put out a co-language demo. And this is a great opportunity to get a lot of work. So in a co-language demo, you showcase two different languages. And you can do that by, well, using Dan's example of Spanish, for example, you can do that and put down a telephony recording on your demo where you say for English, press one, and then you repeat that in Spanish, you know, for pressing two. And you can record, for example, a documentary, which perhaps has various words in another language, or a museum exhibit, like a walking tour of a museum exhibit with words that are in another language. So you can put out that co-language demo. It's a great way to get a lot of work. Also, it depends on your marketing ability. And also greatly depends on the competition and where you live. There are a lot of voice actors who live in a foreign country who get a tremendous amount of American English work simply because they live in another country. Well, you can do you can look at that in an opposite way and say, well, you live in the States. Why not try to get foreign language work in the States? It is out there. We get calls every day from our production clients looking for various languages. In fact, a very typical job at a studio would be a client who says, guys, here's a script. We need it translated into 24 different languages and recorded by next week. So we find those voice actors. So if you speak another language, you can have a co-language demo and or a foreign language demo and send out your demos to production studios, because the work is out there. It definitely is.
I get auditions sent from agents, I'd say at least a couple of times a week, that are not appropriate for me because I'm not speaking a foreign language, but they go, like, they may be looking for somebody who speaks Korean, or they speak, you know, looking for somebody who speaks Russian or whatever it might be, right? So a lot of times you just knowing how to do that, or being in kind of the circle, means that other voice actors are also getting auditions. And of course they're generally American rosters. So basically they're looking for recommendations from us, your peers, to go and send these auditions to people who might be appropriate. So if you do have that skill, it's important to let people know, as long as, you know, as long as that skill is, it's a true skill, you're there, it's marketable, and you're good enough at it that you can do it.
And make sure when you market, you're clear in your marketing that about what language you speak, because we get a boatload of demos sent to us every single day, and the vast majority of them have no reference to the language that the demo is in. And occasionally we may look at the attached demo, and we'll realize, oh, it's a Russian speaker or an Arabic speaker or whatever it might be. But we don't even know that when the email comes in. So reference your letters. Make it clear that you are, for example, a Native American English speaker or a Korean speaker or whatever it might be. Make that super clear in your marketing.
We have another question that has been endorsed in the chat, and I like this one. So this one is a kind of pivoting a little bit, but maybe something that everyone might relate to. It says, it's from Luke, is it normal to record yourself for a voiceover job and not like how you sound after you're finished?
Oh my goodness. Yes, it is so normal.
Yes.
It is so freaking normal. So, you know, a lot of people, especially when they're first starting out, don't really like the sound of their voices. And a lot of people feel that their voice may be actually holding them back from not just voiceover success, but success in life. So that is actually something that I coach and help people fix, is their basically your instrument. This is an instrument, and we have to tune this instrument in order to use it to the best of its ability. And there's a lot of voice actors who aren't really using their instrument to its best ability. Women have 17 notes in their voice and men have 22 notes in their voice. And we generally are only using about 4 or 5 in the middle, believe it or not, in our normal conversation. So it's really, I think it's incumbent upon all of us as voice actors to understand all aspects of our job and our business. So that includes the audio side, that includes the using your instrument properly. And of course, the most important thing of all is communicating effectively. I always say, you know, when we talk about voice acting, they shouldn't call us voice actors or voiceoverists. We should be called communicators, because that is truly our job. And the words on the page really don't matter to anybody in the script if we don't actually connect with them on an emotional level first. the way our brains process the sounds that we hear, it actually has to affect us emotionally first. Sound we process in our brain through our amygdala first and then into our prefrontal cortex. So the amygdala is the part that determines emotion and all of that. And if we can get past that, then we can get to the prefrontal cortex where logic is. And that's where people actually listen to our words. But if we didn't get through that emotional part first, then really what good is the words that we're saying? So the words are really important to us as voice actors, because when we look at that script, we can take that and say, okay, this is my roadmap. This is exactly, everything is here. And I have a process that I teach for breaking all of that down. And that way you always know whatever it is that you're doing, what your intentions are, but I also teach you how to use your instrument properly so that your sound, your actual sound, reflects the emotions that you're trying to communicate. A lot of people are very unaware that they don't use all the notes in their voice, and you don't have to use all, but many people are unaware that they only use 3 or 4 notes in their voice. So we need to do a lot more than that as voice actors. So it is very normal to not like your voice at first, but it is something that you can work on and improve, and it will help you in both your voice acting and in your life.
And to boot, the kind of the sucky thing, guys, is that one of the most necessary characteristics of a successful voice actor is to sound natural, right? But when a voice actor is concerned about the quality of their voice, they're not natural. They hold back whether they feel they need to make their voice lower or higher or change this or do that, or they're concerned about the quality of their voice. They're so focused on the quality of their voice that they no longer sound natural. So that sort of defeats the entire purpose of being a voice actor. The vast majority of scripts, clients are saying, yeah, give us just your real voice. So one of the things that we coach at Edge is that you need to trust your voice. And it's great, work with Dan, work with the coach and expand your voice, understand your voice, but trust it. You know, don't hold back. Just be comfortable with your natural voice. And even then, after working with Dan, and you, even after that, if you still listen back to your recordings and you say, you know, man, like my voice is weird. It's too high in pitch, it's too fast, it's too slow, it's too low, whatever it is, don't worry about it. Because if people are hiring you, if clients are hiring you for it, that means that they like it. And who cares what you think about it? It's all about what the client wants. So if the client wants your voice, then give them your voice. Trust it. Be comfortable when you read. And the more comfortable you are when you read and the more trusting of your voice you are, the better you'll sound. And that's the positive cycle you need to be in, right? It's when the voice actors who are who are so concerned about their voice, they hold back. Well, then they don't sound as good. So they are more concerned. So they hold back even more. And that's the negative cycle. So be positive, trust your voice, love your voice.
Here's the thing, confidence. Confidence is key in everything that we do. I ask a lot of times my students, I say like, okay, well, what is this script trying to communicate? And a lot of times they're like, well, confidence. And I'm like, yes, it absolutely is. But it wouldn't matter what script you were reading because they all require confidence. As the actor, we have to communicate confidence, truth in the context of a lie. That's what we are doing, because we wouldn't use these words. We wouldn't say these words normally. So all acting is truth in the context of a lie. So we have to be able to communicate whatever that is very confidently. If the character we're portraying lacks confidence, is demure or there are a million different words, weak, whatever it is, we still have to communicate that character's persona confidently, even if it's totally contradictory to having confidence. So confidence comes from so many ways, from having proper training, from having a studio that sounds good, being comfortable in your environment. All of these things allow you to be more confident in your delivery and really understanding your script and all of those things. So it really is very important to have that, because it's really what separates good talent from great talent, honestly, because there's a lot of good talent out there. But great talent, there's really just a small difference between good and great.
Yeah, and I think just to kind of close this thing out, I think it's having a sense of self is a challenging thing. And I know if anybody is like me, that's like, wow, this year and a half on so much Zoom, it's more of seeing myself than I've ever been comfortable at, like, looking at. And I'm like, is that how I look? You know, and you have this thing that is bizarre at first, and then you actually get a little more used to it, you know? You just get a little more like, all right, yeah, that's what it is. And I think then you can say, well, I'm used to it, and what makes me feel better about it? And if I'm going to be like super, I'm going to highlight Dan, actually, when we first got on the Zoom, he was like, hang on, I'm going to go get a hat. I think I'd feel good in a hat. And he went and put a hat on because that was going to make him feel good for the session. And I just thought, like, what a wonderful way to, like, prepare yourself for your best self, you know, when you're doing your thing. So it's just kind of part of our journey is, like David said, you know, love your voice, own it, get used to it, just do it. And the more you do it, the more you're like, this is me. And then it's just easier to be you, I think. Because you're like, ah, okay, yeah, there's, okay, that, oh, I got to fix this, but everything else is fine. You know, and you sort of, it becomes part of your labor, is just knowing yourself in this weird personal way that we've chosen to do for some reason. So hopping over to some, okay, this is a little bit, this might get in the weeds, but I don't want to ignore it. So Lexi is asking, Dan, what are the basic steps to edit and master audio in any DAW experience? I don't know if this is a very long conversation or if you have like a rundown or how you want to tackle this, but I thought I'd throw it out.
Well, let me just talk about it conceptually rather than specifics, because that makes a lot more sense in general. And a lot of people aren't going to understand the specifics anyway, because it's just without demonstrating it or without showing you. But, you know, mostly, people are looking for ways to do this job more quickly and efficiently. And especially the editing part, because as I always say, it's not exactly the fun part of the job. Editing is the least creative, the least exhilarating to me. I find that, you know, it's kind of the boring part, even though I've been doing it for 20 some odd years now. But the way to get faster at all of this, and nobody's going to like this answer, is to actually just do it over and over and over again. It's really about experience and doing it. I can make some recommendations. Quick keys for any DAW, using your keyboard as much as possible rather than mousing around and doing, you know, using that. That's definitely going to help you with your speed. Obviously, listening. You cannot sacrifice listening. Remember, once it leaves your studio, nobody's looking at your sound. It's so important that we remember that in the end, is that this is about sound. It's not about what we see on the, somebody said trackball mouse. Yeah, right here, Kensington trackball mouse. I love this baby. I couldn't go anywhere without it. That's huge for real estate. You know, you're not mousing around your whole desk. So yeah, those are things that make you faster. As far as mastering your audio and whatnot, I would definitely discourage most of you from really diving into that early on. I think you can play around with it, but as you are working on actual auditions and that sort of thing, you know, most of the time you're not going to be responsible for mastering your audio or making it broadcast ready. Most of the audio you're sending out is going to other engineers like myself that will do that sort of thing on our end. And it is really important that you sound that the things that you do, or I should say really that you don't do a whole lot to your audio in general, because we're all in different places. We all have different rooms, different equipment, things like that. If you are in a dialogue with another talent, for instance, and I'm creating a commercial or something, doesn't matter what, but I, and it's a husband and wife dialogue, Well, you might be, one person might be in San Francisco, the other person in Des Moines, the engineer is in Chicago, whatever it is, right? Well, we need to make sure that the talents sound like they're in the same room in the end. And if one person is doing all this EQing and compressing and things like that, then I can't undo that stuff. So it really is generally the most accepted that you just send your audio raw with good levels, record with good levels. So when you're the recording engineer, you have one responsibility, as all recording engineers do, and that is to capture the best quality sound that you possibly can. So that means the best sound through the microphone in a great room. And when that starts with getting good levels. So when you go up to the microphone, whenever you're reading any script, and even if you're reading one script and then changing to a different type of script, you want to check your levels. Make sure that your levels are somewhere between minus 12 and minus 6 dB on your meters. You're going to turn your gain up clockwise or counterclockwise in order to achieve those levels. So whatever your preamp is, your interface, your microphone, that's what it gets connected to, is your preamp or interface. You'll turn the gain knob clockwise or counterclockwise to increase or decrease your gain in order to achieve levels that are generally between minus 12 and minus 6 dB. Of course, it's going to fall a little bit lower than that at times, and it might peak a little higher than that too. Now, don't go over digital zero, because that'll be clipping and create distortion. So you want to be somewhere, you know, probably peaking around minus 3, minus 2 at the most. The other thing that's about this, and I know that this question has been kind of going through the chat a little bit, is by recording with good levels, somewhere between minus 12 and minus 6, you don't have to normalize. It wouldn't be necessary to do it at all if you record with good levels. Now, ACX might say normalize to minus 3. So just because they say that, you might as well go ahead and do it. But if you've recorded with good levels, there's a good chance that you just really won't have to, that it normalizing still probably may not change anything at all. And the thing about, you know, normalization, it's really just a step that you don't have to do if you record with good levels to begin with. The other thing is it tricks people oftentimes into thinking that they're in good shape when they're recording with levels that are too low, and then they suddenly normalize, and then suddenly they hear all this noise in the background that they've never heard before. Well, that's the result of normalizing, because it's bringing everything up to a certain point. And generally, that's what happens with people who record too low, is they think they have this super low noise floor, but when in fact they don't. And then they normalize and everything gets boosted up by the amount that they normalized. And some people are normalizing significantly, increasing by 10, 12 dB. Well, that's a lot. And then your noise floor comes up relative to that. So you really do want to make sure that you're recording with good levels to begin with. And that means every time you approach a new script or a new style, for instance, I had a political spot, believe it or not, that I did yesterday, and it was a new client for both the agency and for me, and they didn't know what this client wanted. So they actually had me read this script 8 different ways so that they had all their bases covered. And that actually required me to check my levels each time, because some were a little bit softer and a little bit more intimate, and others were a little bit louder and more aggressive. It's kind of an attack ad. And the funny thing is they ended up with, "We want it to sound whimsical." I'm like, okay. So, you know, that's not what was my first impression. But that's okay. We, you know, we accommodated, but that did require that I check my levels each time, making sure that, you know, everything looks good every time. Sorry. Just hope I didn't hurt all you guys. I just banged into the mic.
So a couple of thoughts. Thanks, Dan. Yeah. 8 times is quite a bit. Hopefully they covered you monetarily for that. A few things, everyone. One is both Siobhan and Dan mentioned DAW. Dan, you pronounce it by the initials DAW. Just for those of you who don't know, that is an acronym or an initialism for Digital Audio Workstation. That's your recording software. And in case you're wondering what the word normalization and compression mean, they are two different technological ways of helping ensure that the volume peaks are smaller. So your voice, or the volume of your voice, doesn't appear to get louder and lower in volume. It's more of a consistent level. I would add on one thing to what Dan said, and that is always ask your client what they want, whether or not they want raw audio or not. Now, hopefully a client is considerate and tells you that they want raw audio or processed audio, but sometimes clients don't think. Number one, they forget that you can't read their mind. Number two, they may not think about what it is that they need. Number three, they may not even know what it is that they need. And if you're dealing with a small client who doesn't have an engineer, they may want processed audio. They may want you to normalize the audio. So for that reason, you, again, should work with someone like Dan. I keep pushing Dan here, but he's good. But work with Dan and make sure he can set up a template or something for you. So if a client says they do want you to normalize or compress your audio because they want finished, processed, broadcast-ready audio from you, then you can give it to them. So work with Dan, let Dan make a template, or at least learn from Dan, or somewhere learn how to finalize your audio in case you have to do it. I will totally agree with Dan that on our end, we have engineers here at Edge, and we really want voice actors to send us raw audio. We can process it ourselves. I saw in the chat, someone asked about how to raise levels without raising the noise floor. It's a tricky thing, and without a lot of experience, it can be tough to do. You can rely on gates, which is another sort of device that can help get rid of some of the unwanted noise, but that can cause other issues. It's always better to leave someone who has experience to do this stuff, like Dan said, but be prepared for the client who says, we need you to do it.
Yeah, what I really want to emphasize, you know, we can talk about EQ and compression, and I talk about it in my book, and these are all processes that we use to master audio or to make it broadcast ready. But the important thing to understand is that I've been doing this for 25 years, working with compression and working with EQ. And even when I went to recording school back in 1995, they showed me how to twist the knobs, and they showed me why and told me why I would want to twist the knobs and push the faders and all of that stuff. But I didn't really learn until I actually was able to experience it, right? And it takes a long time to experience it. And not only does it take a long time to experience it as an individual, but I've also had the benefit of experiencing it from one talent to the next, right? So I'm not always working with the same person, not always listening to the same audio. I have the benefit of making comparisons, 20 years worth of that benefit. So it's just something that I can hear instantaneously as to what's going on, because I've heard so many things, and often one right after the other. I mean, I've heard auditions, you know, that I've sent off many times over, sometimes, you know, 50, 60 people on an audition, and I'm listening to those 50, 60 talent before I send them off to the client to choose. So I literally can hear one after the other, and I know whose sounds are good and whose sounds are bad, and who knows what they're doing with compression or EQ, and who did use EQ and compression and who didn't, and all that. And oftentimes, you know, when you're working as an individual, you just don't have the benefit of that, and you couldn't possibly, because many of you are just getting into voiceover in general. You're focused on the performance, as you should be, because that really is the most important part. We can take care of the rest, but focus on your performance first. And then if you want to learn this other stuff, you certainly can, but understand it really is something that has to be experienced. It's not just simply twisting a knob or pushing a fader or pushing a button. It really is something that has to be experienced. When I left recording school, the first thing I did was I set up my mixing board on my dining room table and put on some headphones and took some recorded material and started listening back and started messing with compression and started messing with EQ. And you have to remember, this was not digital. I actually, you know, had a rack of analog gear sitting next to my mixing board. You know, I mean, it's a miracle my wife ever married me, because for the first, you know, couple years that we knew each other, I was literally loading giant PA systems into our apartment at night at 4 in the morning. You know, so I had this equipment all around all the time, and I'd move it out and I'd move it back in, sometimes 3 to 4 nights a week. So, you know, it was a big deal. So I had all this stuff. In fact, I still have some of it. I need to sell a lot of it actually. Cause I haven't used some of it in years, but anyway, it has to be experienced. So it's not something that I can just say, well, twist this knob or twist that knob. It's going to be different for everybody too, because your room is different than my room. My microphone might be different than your microphone. And even if both of those things are exactly the same, we're still different people. We still have different vocal qualities. So what EQ settings or compression settings might work for you are probably not going to be the same for me. And on top of that, if you're doing a monster truck spot 1 minute, and then you're doing a real intimate, dark chocolate spot, then, you know, that's going to be different settings as well. So those are just things to keep in mind. So it's something that has to be experienced. You can't expect to be a master at any of these things in just one training class or overnight, you know, just doesn't happen that way. Most overnight successes took many years to get there.
Dan, just as an example, if folks were to train with you, would it be possible to do something like send a recording sample to the education department for to be in a file, and in the session you listen to that recording and then talk to the student and do a rundown of what's good and bad and talk about EQ and compression and sort of go through that? Is that an example of a kind of session to have with you?
Yeah, I do all kinds of things like that. I mean, there's definitely people that are submitting audio to me for just to evaluate it. You know, what do I need to do to make this sound better? That's certainly something that can happen. You know, I give my students homework, which, you know, might scare a few of you, but I promise you that it's really the most important element that we have, because the learning happens in the listening. I say that all the time. In fact, I really need to have a t-shirt that says that the learning happens in the listening, because that's really where you're experiencing all these things. You're experiencing your performance and you're experiencing your sound, and then you can change things, and then you're experiencing that. And how did it make it better? How did it make it worse? Right. So these are all that's like I said, that's the learning. And I'm here to guide you through that process. If you'll have me.
I want to ask one more question. I want to pop over to performance too, for folks who are thinking about performance stuff in our last few minutes of the session today. This is from Adam. This also was retweeted in the chat. Dan, do you use any techniques to create a second or third take on a character after you have mentally created the first take? I think this is great, actually, in talking about your political spot. The whimsical political, I really want to hear. He says, I can get so locked into a voice, and I have a hard time adjusting for multiple takes. I'd love your
I love that. I love it when people get into a rut, because it gives me a real opportunity to teach you something that is going to help you break free from that rut, no matter what kind of rut you're in. If you just cannot seem to break free from the same delivery, then pick your favorite cartoon character and do the spot as that. It doesn't really matter what it's about. It's just very simple, and it should be the most outrageous, outlandish thing that you can possibly come up with. Do it, and I say a cartoon character because that's usually the easiest for people to visualize, but it really could be anything. You could do it as your Aunt Nancy, I don't know. But the thing is just do it completely differently from anything else you've tried, and then immediately go back to it. Because you're going to change. Your delivery will change. I promise you 100%. If you break that mindset that you're in by doing something with it that's just so outlandish and off the wall, and maybe even makes you laugh, even if it's a really sad spot, if you go right back to it immediately after that, I promise you your delivery is going to change.
David, any thoughts on that as well?
Yeah. I like what Dan, what you said a lot, and it's so right on. It's interesting because from my end, as a director, I see voice actors, and I'm very often the liaison between the client and the video and the artist, you know, the graphic designer, the animator, and the voice actor. And there's a lot of decision making that goes on. And very often the clients come into a recording session. And by the way, when I say they come into a recording session, I don't mean necessarily even in our studio, it could be done remotely, but everyone goes into this thing with their own idea of what the voice may sound like, but it is pretty hard to communicate what a voice will sound like in text. You can email someone and say, yeah, I'm looking for the voice to be higher pitched or lower pitched, but a lot of it comes down to when the voice actor starts experimenting. And as the voice actor, if you are, oh, this is interesting, by the way, this is a tie back to something we spoke about earlier. If you are completely comfortable and confident with your voice, oh, sorry about that. If you're completely comfortable and confident with your voice, if you're willing to just be vocally free, you can do so much more. And then sometimes even a slight shift to your body can drastically change the quality of your voice. I've seen voice actors actually change their clothes or put on a hat or put on a pair of sunglasses. And once they put on the hat and the sunglasses, then they actually have a different take on the character and they sound different. It's amazing how much can be done with some slight shifts. Also, it helps having a client who is willing to work with you. Some clients are very adamant about being very precise about the character that they want, the sound that they want, but they can't communicate it. Some, I don't know, you know, I'm going to get sidetracked here and I don't need to do that. But I, again, it comes down to just having fun, guys. Being vocally free. That's the, I think, the key word that you should take home from this conversation. Be vocally free. Just trust your voice and explore and practice, by the way. I think Siobhan and Dan and I will all agree, you know, just practice. Practice taking, as Dan said, listening to a character on a cartoon or an animated production and mimicking it and exploring your voice. And as Dan said, you know, don't stick with just 3 or 4 or 5 notes in your voice, but let's hear all 17 or 22 of them, you know, and just, yeah, be free. Have fun.
One thing I'd like to add that I know, you know, we've talked to James Andrews about is for doing these multiple styles of takes, you can try to change your audience too. So think about who you're talking to.
Oh, yeah.
And you might speak differently to your romantic partner than to your boss. Hopefully you do. You know, and so you can sort of change your audience, and who you're speaking to and what you, and that kind of, modifies a little bit of the intention or tone.
That modifies a lot, Siobhan, and even where the, what the environment is, right? If you pretend you're talking to your boss, for example, and you're in a small little room, like maybe a small office somewhere, a cubicle in an office building, in a corporate office building, you talk differently to that boss than if you were in a presentation hall speaking from row Z and, you know, to someone on the podium, if your boss was on the podium. I mean, you can explore who you're talking to and why you're talking to them and where they are hearing you.
All of these things are certainly, you know, ways that you can go about changing your voice instantly. If you really want to, you know, just the sound overall, your voice is made up of 5 elements: pitch, pace, tone, volume, and melody. And you can change any one of those things at any time. Just changing your volume alone can change the read because, you know, as David said, where you are, the where is very important to the play. A conversation can happen anywhere, right? It can happen laying in bed next to somebody, or it can happen in a busy New York City street. So if I change my volume to adjust for those things, then the read is going to change. And that's really one of the easiest things, because we generally do, especially beginning voice actors, only think of volume for emphasis, but there's 8 other ways to do it. So, and then combinations of those. So all of these things come into play. So if you were to just change, you know, one of those elements, pitch, pace, tone, volume, or melody, then that's going to give you a different take on it.
Okay. Pitch, pace, tone, volume, melody. Yes. Okay. We got you. We got you. I want to say Malia or am I got, yes, Malia. Okay. Pitch, pace, tone, volume, melody. We are killing it. Y'all, this time has just flown the heck by, and this chat is hilarious, as always. And I gotta say, you know that you're, like, a VO nerd when, like, we've been talking about, like, you know, EQ and compression for almost an hour. And I'm just like smiling. I'm like, oh, I love this stuff. And it always goes fast. So, and there's so much to talk about. VO is very all encompassing, which makes my brain feel overwhelmed. But there's also a joy in just getting into the weeds of it. I know that there are so many more questions for Dan. I'm throwing this in the chat as I do. You can get $25 off of coaching with the AMA code at this link, and you can request a Dan Friedman to come and talk to you about all this great, wonderful, nerdy stuff, or David himself. We've got two audio engineers. I mean, and I just want to say, two people coming from the music industry into VO and being, you know, nerds for that, nerds for a DAW. Great session. David, any, well, I guess I'll start with Dan. Dan, any closing remarks in the last minute we've got here?
Closing remarks, yes. I'm tough. I'm a tough coach. If you want somebody to crack the whip on you and to not let you get away with a bunch of BS, I'm your guy. Trust me. I will turn you into a voice actor one way or another. We might get there kicking and screaming, but we'll do it. So if you're dedicated, you like homework, and you want to have some fun, and I promise I'll be kind. I'm tough, but I'm kind. So we'll get through it, and I'll make you a voice actor, and I can help you with your studio and all that stuff too, and tune your instrument, all that good stuff. So, you know, hey, let's make some stuff happen.
That's true. Actually, he is a tough love, but a love indeed. David, any closing remarks on your end?
Yeah, so it's Dan, I can't believe how long you've been coaching with Edge. It's amazing. You mentioned it at the beginning of the session. Wow, time does go by fast. Yeah. There's a reason why we have coaches like Dan on our roster. You know, all of our coaches have a different specialty, and Dan is a great, great coach. As Siobhan is fantastic at what she does, everyone, shouldn't we applaud Siobhan? The energy, the clarity, it's great. And most importantly, as I do every episode, I thank you for joining us. You guys rock for giving us an hour and listening so intently and asking some dynamite questions. It's really hard. I've said this before. It's really hard to look at the you know, the video, my camera, but also look at the chat at the same time. But your questions are dynamite. Like, you guys are really into this. It's impressive. And yeah, I do wish we had more time, but the time is up. So I hope you join us in 2 more weeks. When we are back for episode 40.
Woo! Yes. Yeah, it's, cool. It's a skill that I've developed over time to look at the chat and the Zoom and the camera lens and the humans. And with that, I do want to say, as always, our coaches donate this time to us because this is a free service that we want to maintain for community support and just friendship and hangout time in this weird world we live in. So if you want to pour some love to Dan in the chat, I'll make sure it gets back to him. It's one of the things that I do. Dan, we appreciate you giving us this hour of your time and being and just having a wonderful morning for me, evening and afternoon for others. I super appreciate it and you. And just so you all know, for our upcoming programming, we are back to the every other week. So today, I can't believe that today is September 23rd. So that means that we're back on October 7th with just me and David for episode 40. And then on the 21st, we do have Issa Diaz for his first time doing a panel with us here for Ask Me Anything. He's elusive as well. So it's wonderful to share this space with you. Thank you all for being here. You are wonderful people who brighten up my week and my days. And I love that there's like musical theater fun times in this chat. Okay. Y'all, I hope you have a great, great evening. And please, please hit us up for coaching with Dan if that strikes your fancy or further questions. I am the voice of the literal voice of our social media. So if you also want to just tweet about like what good experience you had with us and with Dan, you'll find from today's posting that I've got Dan's socials tagged so you can at him as well. So thank you, my good people, and please, please be well. Well wishes to you. See you on October 7th, which is also the day after my birthday. So Libra season is nigh. All right, everybody. Mwah. Take care. Bye.